It's a great honor and pleasure to be here at this ICA event. After this video, I actually took an easier route that I don't have to speak much after this. We pretty much, you know, talks about our work. I'll maybe 2-3 minutes. I'll speak on my own inspiration, and then I can take some questions. So, friends, when I started this in 2003, my inspiration, as the video also referred to, was from ideas of Swami Vivekananda. Swami Vivekananda's own philosophy, the central theme of which was divinity in each human being, and all of us have the infinite capacity to be pure, infinite capacity to be selfless, infinite capacity to be loving, caring, whatever you consider good and great. We have the infinite capacity to express all those things in our each of our actions day to day. This is what Swami Vivekananda meant by divinity. And when I came in touch with these ideas, I really felt that this is the highest and most manliest pursuit which one can take. So that this finiteness within us, which any kind of, you know, insecure thought, selfish thought brings, I wanted to, you know, win over any such limitation, at least try to do that to the extent possible. So these were my points of inspiration. Vivekananda himself drew this from the ancient Vedanta philosophy of India, which, you know, Vedanta first came in the Upanishads, the Gita. They all are based on the Vedanta, which says that there is an unchanging divine dimension in each creature, in fact, in the whole of the existence. So we are all one. Essentially, we are all one. And therefore, in serving any other person, we are actually, you know, serving and reaching out to our most deepest stratum of our own selves, because everything around us is a manifestation of our extended self only. It's our extended self, which whatever we see around us. So, friends, this was my inspiration in a small way. With 3 children I started, and I had no idea how it will scale. In fact, I had no idea of, you know, I did not have any goal of scaling. I did not think about those lines. My motivation was, my goals were always inner in nature, that I wanted to continue doing this work for the whole of my life. That was my goal. So my goals were not external. External goals got, you know, translated or expressed from the inner mission or inner goals which I kept, which was that for the whole of my life, I want to lead a life of service. I want to express selflessness in actions. So these were the values. My work was not based on any, you know, cerebral idea. There is no cerebral idea involved. It's a very, very simple thing. I always say that the work that Parivaar does is a work which any mother or any homemaker, housewife is doing on a magnified scale. So there is no fancy rocket science involved. It's a simple manifestation of and expression of values of love, care, servicefulness. This we try to, this is like all our processes, all our, you know, working models are, we are the stamp for these values. And all our sevavratis, like we have now more than 1,000 people working for us full time. And large number of them are, you know, just bare living kind of modest remuneration they get. And we are drawn to this work only because of these ideas of service, because they also want to be an agent of change and participate in something which is transformative. So this is the basis of our work. And this is an unlimited kind of thing. We do not, you know, there are no end goals as such, like for the whole organization or for any work. Whatever difference we try to make in anyone's life, you know, that is a very fulfilling thing. We do not determine our goals only by numbers, but by grace of God, so many hands have joined not just as, you know, volunteers, workers, but also contributors, donors, supporters. So we never imagined, even 5 years back, the Madhya Pradesh work, I never imagined it would become like this, because I was only working in West Bengal from 2003. So opportunities come, and you know, Swami Vivekanand used to say that manifest your divinity and rest everything else will harmoniously arrange itself around it. This has been my mantra, that if we remain pure, if we remain serviceful, then we become an, you know, instrument of the divine and all gets done through us. Thank you so much. It's an honor and deep pleasure to be here. I will take any questions. If there are any questions, I can take it. Yeah, please. So, yeah, our Madhya Pradesh work is completely based on community involvement, right from the offering of venue. We have right now 135 these meals and education centers, seva kutis, right from the starting of, you know, the community only has to invite us. All these villages, panchayats and communities have invited us, and then only we have gone. So it's our first condition is that the village community has to invite us on their panchayat letterhead. And they offer a venue free, lot of voluntary participation in the preparation of the meals, etc. It is the mothers, guardians of the children who involve themselves voluntarily in this process. And teachers, etc. also, to the extent what we will take from the same village or from the nearby areas, though we have to train them a lot because these are such interior areas. But the whole idea is that unless local human resources get developed, we can't expect too many people, say from cities, idealistic people, they'll come down to the villages to work. Maybe like very few of them will be there and they can lead and energize and intellectually guide. But at the end, the real, you know, the muscle of such work in such scale in a country like India have to be local people. So we actually like the kind of youth also we take, apart from the local community, the our own people. We don't visit any big campuses for recruitment for, you know, like the, say, the Tata Institute of Social Sciences, etc. In fact, we go to district town or even tehsil town, which is a sub-unit of a district, wherever colleges, etc. are there. And such youth, because they are best place, they are from that area. If they are inspired, energized, trained, they can be agents of change in their area. So our whole working model and working approach is based on human resources and whatever is possible from the local communities. Thank you.
The one question that I have is concerning your residential. When you first came up, which is a very good thing. But the question is the one of legal guardianship. I mean, what was the situation? You took street children.
Right.
Who were they? Who was responsible for them at that time? Right. How did you confirm that you had the rights to remove them from wherever they were to your residence?
Yeah, so let me, it's a very good and, you know, informed question, technical question in this domain. Now basically there is an, you may say it down, sir, thank you. So there is an entire JJ framework, now juvenile justice framework in India, which came in 2016. Before that there were earlier laws, they are now being overridden by the Juvenile Justice Act. So there are, in each district there is a framework called Child Welfare Committee, CWC, and they actually like have to, you have to get a license under the JJ Act, and you have to get the, send the list of children to CWC, have it ratified from them. These are the things. So these regulatory guidelines are there for all shelter homes. And we are not just a shelter home, we are also a residential school. So we have a, you know, dual kind of identity because we also run our own school. So our affiliation is, you know, both with the education department as well as with the JJ framework. So all those things we take care of. Yeah. So, if there are no more questions, or I can answer later on also. So, thank you so much.
Thank you. That was very, very good and very stirring, amazing work that you do. I would now like to call upon Abhay Bhushan, who has been with ICA for umpteen years and is the heart and soul of this organization, as you know. I would like to call upon him to thank, do his heartfelt thank you, and then we'll move on.
This is really a great pleasure to see people who are changing the destiny of so many thousands. So really thank you from our community here. You. How to live its life in service. And this is just absolutely wonderful. We will be supporting Parivaar. We'll be sending a donation from ICA. And this other thing that's here, on your sheet you will see this the brochure there which says, be an agent of change. So we wish we get inspired by him and we become agents of change, or at least empower agents of change. And one way you can do it is by contributing to ICA, and you can choose any project you want. We support, as Reshma mentioned, 30 projects. They're there. You can, or you can support Parivaar or some other one if you want to do for the San Jose Spartan Food Bank. You can do that, or ICA General Fund, then our committee decides to do add donations to it to send and support the wonderful work that these agents of change are doing in India and the United States. As you know, our community here has grown. When we first started Indians for Collective Action, it was first generation Indians. Now we have second and even third generation Indians here, and who have told us that why don't we do something together for our local communities here also. And this is a great idea. So over the longer term, slowly we will also starting together see where the needs of our community here are in the US, both Indian and non-Indian general community, and how we can support that. And so we have started Sukham, which now has spun off, which supports the elderly care and palliative care. And there's a number of things that we're going to be doing here. So please, there are donation forms and envelopes there, so if you don't have a check, you can always mail it. We also accept contributions from Fidelity Charitable, Schwab Charitable, any of the charitable fund. If you work for Google or any of the leading companies, Microsoft, VMware, we're all covered by there. Apple does 2-for-1 donation. If you work for Apple, contribute to Apple, you get triple the money. I forget, so you can choose the program in the comment as to where you want to send it. And your donation form, you can make what project you're supporting, or ICA General Fund. And Professor Tulke Mehta, the founder for ICA, and the general inspiration for all of us for doing great work in the local community as well as in India. Here they have started a fund in his memory for T.K. Mehta Memorial Fund with ICA, and whatever funds are collected will work with the family to see the area that he was interested in. They would like to contribute. So you can write P.K. Mehta Memorial Fund in your contribution, and it will all be added up. Quite a few contributions have been received because that's one of the desires he and his family expressed, that he would like to further the work of ICA. So I really thank you, and tonight it's my great pleasure for the wonderful work he's doing it, and thank you all for your time. Thank you.
To come and address us. Would you like us to play your video first, or would you like to talk? Ah, perfect. Thank you.
The start of summer.
Hang on. No video right now. He's going to speak. There is a hand mic.
There is
one.
No,
there is.
Yeah,
at the outset, many thanks to ICA, Reshma, Mayuranki, and the entire team that has made this event possible. I know how hard each of you has worked to make a success of this program. And thank you to each and every one of you who's here today. For us at Pani, this is a wonderful opportunity to share what work we've been doing in Maharashtra, to share with the intention above all of soliciting help and support for villages in Maharashtra for the work that we've been doing. I'll come to that later. I want to talk, beginning with how this journey has evolved. Can I have house light? This glare otherwise is too much. Struggling with the light. Can't see anyone's faces. So this journey of Pani Foundation begins with a show called Satyamev Jayate. Thank you. So Satyamev Jayate is a show which aired in the years 2012 to 2014 and dealt with 24 different social topics. For those who have not seen the show, it was something in the nature of a talk show format and was hosted by an actor called Amir Khan, who of course many Indians are familiar with, perhaps some of the others may not be, that's why I explain. It was a mainstream show, it was an entertainment television, it was on Sunday mornings at 11 and it was telecast in every single Indian language. And it was an experiment on our part to see whether we could bring these topics into people's homes, into people's lives. Too often, topics of social importance get relegated to a certain kind of audience, to a certain kind of person, someone who's socially concerned, a policy maker, someone in government. But the aam aadmi, the common man, often remains aloof from these topics, both from information about it, concerns about it, and action about it. Our attempt was to see whether we could use communication to change that. Could we take this into the lives of people? Could we make people part of this conversation? And we were delighted when we found out that not only were people watching the show in very, very large numbers, but that people were acting on the call to action given at the end of every show. So, I'll just give you one example of it. One of the episodes that Satyamev Jayate dealt with was alcoholism. And alcoholism, the thrust of what we were saying is that alcoholism is a disease. So do not victimize the alcoholic. We need to find a cure to the disease, and AA does this work free of cost. And we had flashed AA's number in the show. In 70 years of AA's existence, it had something like 35,000 members. 3 to 4 weeks after that show, there were 3.5 lakh people who had registered to get into rehab. And it became one of the largest programs for rehabilitation of alcoholics in rehab world. On each of the topics, we discovered that there was action happening. And the action was happening at every level of society. So it was happening in civil society, it was happening in government, it was happening among bureaucrats. So a lot of different parts of society were getting mobilized and there was converging action on the ground. So we, so to say, tasted blood. And we felt that if one show done, you know, for an hour on Sunday mornings from 11 to 12 can bring about so much change, can we push the envelope further? Can we see whether communication can do more by shutting down the show? And by working on only one topic? Because you need a certain focused attention also if you have to make a significant change on ground. So I was the director of Satyamev Jayate, and Amir and some of the others in the core team, we got together, we decided let's shut down the show and let's work on one topic. And that topic we decided should be water. And the geography we elected to work in was Maharashtra, which is a fairly large state, the second largest state in India. Why did we select water? We selected water because water lies at the intersection of many, many different issues. Without water, there is no education, no health, no livelihoods, no gender justice. Truly, without water, there is no life. So water gives an opportunity to have a multiplier effect on many, many other things. Now, what is it that we wanted to do about water? So, before talking about specifically what we did with water, I want to point out that during Satyamev Jayate, we discovered that in India, there is no problem that has not already been solved. This slightly provocative statement to make, but it is true. In India, truly, there is no problem that has not been solved. The only problem is that we have not solved it to scale. So you go to Gadchiroli and you see the wonderful work that the Andhras are doing. You look at the wonderful work that Vinayak Lohani and his team are doing. You will find on solid waste management, there is fantastic work being done somewhere. On female feticide, there is fantastic work done being somewhere. On child sexual abuse, there is fantastic work being done somewhere. But alas, this work gets relegated to very small geographies. It does not get the scale that it needs. So this is a subcontinent. We are now talking of 1/6 of humanity. And why is this? Is there some way in which communication can help in taking a proven solution to scale? So as is obvious, we are filmmakers by background. So there is no reason why Amir or I or any of us would have any experience in how to run a non-profit. But we said, let's try and stick to our basic dharma. Who are we? We are communicators. Can we as communicators take a proven solution to scale? So now we come to the question, what is that proven solution as regards water? Now when I'm talking about the problem of water, I'm talking about the problem of drought in rural Maharashtra. Because water has many dimensions, rural, urban and so on. So for the purposes of my conversation, I'm talking about rural Maharashtra, I'm talking about our villages. In Maharashtra, we find that drought has been effectively eliminated from a handful of villages in the most drought-prone rain shadow areas of Maharashtra. Which are these villages? A lot of you would know the village of Raligarh Siddhi, where Anna Hazare started his work. A lot of you would know the village of Hivre Bazar, where Popatrao Pawar has been working in Ahmednagar. For those who don't know, basically these are villages which get 300 millimeters or less of rainfall every year, and that too not certain. And yet these villages have water for agriculture, for animal husbandry, for drinking water, complete water security. Why? Because these villages have practiced what is known as decentralized watershed management. What is decentralized watershed management? The heart of the concept is that whatever rainwater you get, the idea is to find ways to slow down that water in a manner in which it percolates into the groundwater and brings up the water table. There is a single sentence which sums up the science of watershed management. We have to teach running water to walk, we have to teach walking water to stand, and we have to teach standing water to percolate. So the idea is you reduce the time signature of water, to put it in engineering terms, in order that water has the maximum opportunity to go into the groundwater where it will be safe from evaporation and from runoff, and will be available after the monsoon year round. Is this very difficult to do? No. Is this very high tech? No. And yet, this work has not been done. Has the government tried to do it? Yes. Has the government spent resources on doing it? Yes. And yet, the problem had not been solved. So we try to ask ourselves that what is it that has prevented people from doing this in large numbers? What is it that has prevented this from becoming a success? And we discovered the problem does not lie in resources. The problem does not lie in money. The problem does not lie in technology. The problem lies in the way we are organized as human beings. Sadly, we live in what can only be described as a fractured society. And the fractures take place on lines of caste. They take place on lines of religion. They take place on lines of politics, and so on and so forth. So we often refer to village communities, but sadly, far too few instances show how we, in far too few instances, do we cooperatively behave as a community. Far too often, we behave as factions who are competing with each other for various things. So the problem we are solving for, above all, is not the problem of water. The problem we are solving for above all is the problem of social unity. If people can come together, then the problem of water could be solved very fast. If people can come together, then It can be solved to scale. Why am I saying it can be solved to scale? Because in a village, if I am a villager, I don't need to worry about the problems of the country. I don't need to worry about the problems of the state, of my district, of my tehsil. I need to worry about the problems of my village and preferably my own field. If I practice watershed management on my field and in my village, I should be able to solve the problem of water for my village. And here is where communication comes in. Could we as communicators, reach out to people and turn this problem, instead of it being a problem of government, instead of being a problem of big companies or donors, could we make people the solution to this problem? Could every village decide that this is my problem and it is my right, my privilege to solve it? So with that in mind, we researched what we could do and we came up with a hypothesis or with a strategy. It's not a hypothesis, it's a strategy. The heart of the strategy was to hold a competition. The competition was called the Satyameva Jayate Water Cup. So we used the Satyameva Jayate name, since that was a name which already a lot of people were familiar with. And we gave this the form of a competition in order to create a mahal, an atmosphere in which people compete as they would in a game with joy, with enthusiasm, with a lot of color, with music, with dance. And I'll come to how we introduced all these elements. So the heart of the competition is that the competing unit is a Gram Panchayat, is the local self-government body of the village. We kept large cash prizes for the winners. So the first year, the prize for the winning village was 50 lakhs, the second prize was 30 lakhs, and the third prize was 20 lakhs of rupees. But other than that, we did not fund the village. The village only received compulsory training. Any village which wanted to participate had to undergo a 4-day residential training, had to send 5 representatives of the village, of which at least 2 had to be women. And that training was designed as an experiential form of training. The training was not classroom training with a blackboard or a whiteboard where, you know, there would be handouts giving engineering drawings and so on. So yes, did we teach the engineering or watershed management? We did. But above all, what we did is we invested the training with the emotion that I can solve this problem. And this was done through various games. I'll just give you one example of a game which was very successful in the Water Cup training module. One of the problems with water and with groundwater in an era of pumps with a lot of horsepower is that water is being drained out competitively using bore wells. So if, you know, I have a 200-foot bore well, my neighbor takes a 300-foot bore well and drains it out from a deeper aquifer. So there's a race to the bottom where the water is being drained out much, much faster than it is recharged. Now, how do you make people aware of it? So we designed a game. So this is the way the game runs. There's a table, not very dissimilar from these tables, on which we place a tub of water. The trainees are divided into 4 teams. Each team has to nominate 1 representative. So the representative are called respectively the grandfather, father, and the grandson. Sorry, this is a patriarchal society. So first the 4 grandfathers come to the tub and they have to pip it out the water out of the tub using a straw into transparent bottles. So the grandfathers go and they start pipetting off the water and all the trainees are cheering the 4 grandfathers on. Come on, grandfather, pump it out faster, pump it out faster. And the grandfathers pump out the water and soon the tub is empty. Now it is the turn of the fathers. The fathers come and the water is replenished in the tub. The fathers go through the same exercise and the water is pipetted out of the tub. Again the tub goes empty. Now it is the turn of the grandsons. But when it is the turn of the grandsons, there is no water in the tub. So they say, how can we play this game? The water is over. And our trainer doesn't say a word. He just stands silently. And all the trainees realize that this is exactly what we have done with Mother Earth. we have pumped out all the water from our aquifers and we've left nothing for the further generations. We've left a barren earth completely devoid of water, of moisture, of vegetation. And even in these cynical times, when often we are not concerned with our fellow human beings, there is still that sense of love and duty towards one's kin, kith and kin, your children, your grandchildren. And that's where the class really realizes that, look, we need to follow a different path. So these trainees go back full of hope, full of this knowledge, and the idea is that they have to go back to their villages. And we have to now involve the larger village in this process, and they have to plan and execute work which will be done during the Water Cup. So like any competition, this has rules. So the rules are that the Water Cup starts on the 8th of April and it ends on the 22nd of May. So it takes place over exactly 45 days. And in those 45 days, the village has to plan and execute all its work. And for the purposes of funds, government helps villages directly, in which Pani Foundation is not an intermediary. Villagers reach out to NRIs, some of whom are in this room and who are really well known for helping the villages in Maharashtra. So that also takes place. Corporates come in, local organizations come in. It's a plug and play system in which over 2,000 organizations have collectively supported villages in order to do this work. So resources we discovered do get available. And starting in the year 2016, in just 3 talukas or 3 blocks of Maharashtra, this year we completed the 4th edition of the Water Cup in 4,706 villages in 24 districts and 76 talukas of Maharashtra. And collectively, the villagers of Maharashtra have created over 500 billion liters of water storage capacity. 100 villages have become drought free. A few dozen villages have got many, many farmer millionaires. But to me, the real achievement in this is not that of water, is not even that of prosperity. It is that the villagers have found a key which will unlock many, many doors. They have discovered the power of social unity. They have discovered the power of their own agency. They have discovered the sweetness that comes when people come together collaboratively in order to solve a common problem. And we believe that once you can do that, this same platform lends itself, and we have no intention of doing that ourselves, but many other people are plugging and playing into it. The same platform can be used for education, can be used for health, can be used for livelihoods, can be used to take farmers further and further on the road towards having a stable and a sustainable livelihood. So without saying any further words, I'd like to show a short clip which shows a little bit of the work that they've been doing.
Yet again, the rains have been poor. Maharashtra was facing a devastating